Oliver N. Green.
Oliver N. Green, and tell me, you wrote a book. What's the name of it?
The title of the book is From the Brush Arbor to the Temple Beautiful.
Where are you from?
I'm from LaGrange, Georgia, Troup County.
Okay, and what Episcopal district of the AME Church is that?
I'm in the 6th Episcopal district.
And in the 6th Episcopal district, you guys have about 590 churches?
In that area, yes.
Okay, AME churches.
AME churches.
Okay, and you here to tell us a little bit about a guy named Richard Allen. You're standing underneath his statue here, and you're going to tell us a little bit about how they got here.
Yeah, Richard Allen was a former slave in Dover, Delaware.
I saw your post.
Delaware, Philadelphia, to join the forces of the other African Americans that were in Philadelphia. Of course, he prayed and bought to pay for his freedom. Then after he paid for his freedom, he paid for the freedom of his brothers and sisters. And of course, then he was released, and he walked from Dover, Delaware to Philadelphia to join the forces of the St. George's Methodist Church at that time. But because of because of social segregation and the seating arrangement, they came to church that particular Sunday, and they were, the members said they were interrupting the service because they sat where they weren't supposed to sit. So they said, if you just let us finish our prayers, we won't disturb you anymore. So that was in 1787. They left the church and filed a suit to become an independent Methodist church. And they named themselves African Americans because there were more African Americans in this movement at that time than there were others. So once they became African American, then they worked together to start the church. Richard Allen was the founder, bought the land, and the church was made from a blacksmith shop at first, and then it became a part of the Methodist structure. But before that time, Richard Allen and his group worked to get an independent church started. The officials of the white church at that time did not want them to do that because they still wanted control. But he proceeded with the idea and purchased this land in 1791, I believe, and it became a part of the property of Richard Allen. And the church bought this from Richard Allen and started the AME Church in 1787. Then it was a challenge in the court as to whether they could be an independent church or not. So they stayed in court until 1816. And when they won the case, they called in delegates and members from Maryland and from New Jersey and from the middle states, it was called at that time, to help form the African Methodist Church.
So in July of 1816, Bishop Allen and Bishop Coker of Maryland met in Baltimore. And when they met in Baltimore, they brought together folks from various states to form the officially formed African Methodist Episcopal Church. And that would have marked the first quadrennial conference, yes or no?
It wouldn't be a quadrennial conference because it had not been in existence 200 years. It would be the first organizational structure for the African Methodist Episcopal Church in the United States of America.
Now, since that time, since 1816, they've held a conference every 4 years.
Every 4 years.
And that's called what?
Quadrennial.
And we're now what? In what number?
We are in the 50th quadrennial, which is 50th quadrennial section, actually meaning the church has been meeting every 4 years since 1816.
So this Episcopal is being a form of government represents an organization that goes all the way back to 1816?
Actually 1787. That's when the walkout occurred, an idea that was conceived at that time.
Excellent. And you've heard one piece that while they were at St. George's, there was a group that that they represented, that they organized under. It was called the Free African Society. And what was the importance and significance of this group?
I would think that the significance of that group was to try to ban the blacks, the Negroes of America at Philadelphia at that time, to come together to create a sense of independence. And this is where the sense of independence began. And it culminated after having been in court 40 years or more, to become the mother, the Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church, and a white bishop from the St. George's actually ordained the church at the dedication service.
If an organization like the Free African Society existed today, what do you think the top priority would be for such an organization?
I think it would be continuing the struggle that we're in to become free Americans so that we have all our freedoms and rights that other people have. To me, that would be the same. And the other focus would be, what can we do to eliminate the images of segregation in the church? See, the church is still the most segregated institution on a Sunday morning that we have. And that doesn't speak too well of a free society. Oh, you're a free society, and you have a right, according to the Constitution, to have religious freedom. And this implemented religious freedom for the African.
Anything you'd like to say to the folks in your hometown, in your home district?
What I want to say to them?
Anything you'd like to say to them?
I would suggest to them that they continue to struggle and keep the doors of the AME Church open, because it represents freedom. It laid the foundation for freedom, and to be a part of a connectional church means you are connected with individuals throughout the world, because we have churches on several continents, not just America.